August 1976, astronaut Neil Armstrong is embarking on a perilous mission, not to the moon, but to the jungle. He is searching for a secret cave system in Ecuador, known as Cueva de los Tayos.
Over 100 people are gathered for this. We're talking Ecuadorian military, British scientists from around the world, university institutions.
Armstrong is no ordinary explorer, and these are no ordinary caves.
There's a legend attached to these caves which involves a metal library made of gold.
There are these books made of metal, inscribed in a mysterious language that no one understands, but presumably that contain some unimaginable store of knowledge just waiting to be discovered.
Armstrong is traveling with Stan Hall, a Scottish engineer, who first alerted him to the possible existence of an ancient library hidden underground. Stan Hall's daughter recounts the pair's extraordinary expedition.
Some people believe that the metal library contained information from a civilization from beyond this planet that showed us how to build the pyramids and other such features in the Earth.
The knowledge contained in this metal library could turn what we think we know about ourselves and our world right on its head.
So what amazing secrets does the library contain?
According to legend, the lost library contains details of a technology that originated on another world. But why is such a story given credence by such a well-known and respected man of science, the great Neil Armstrong? And as some are asking, was his interest in extraterrestrial secrets sparked by a close encounter of his own? Over half a billion people watched Armstrong land on the moon in 1969 as pictures were beamed back to Earth.
That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
But some claim that the transmission was interrupted for a full 2 minutes.
That's unheard of. What happened to those 2 minutes?
NASA vehemently denies anything strange happened. Others aren't so sure.
When Neil Armstrong came back from the moon, almost immediately, stories began to circulate.
Supposedly, while on the moon, Neil Armstrong switches his communication channel to the medical officer and he says something.
Hello, this is Houston, we're copying.
He says, they're on the edge of the crater and they're watching us.
They were relating that they were seeing things on the rim of the crater. And by things, I mean extraterrestrial beings and vehicles.
People report that he was, or we were, warned off the moon. Now, none of these reports can be substantiated.
It's a mind-boggling story, but some find corroboration in Armstrong's behavior on his return to Earth.
Something happened to him up there. He was changed. He was touched.
Neil Armstrong returned from the moon and showed what appears to me to be signs of post-traumatic stress. I think that he encountered things on the journey to the moon and on the lunar surface, much closer encounters than simply watching lights out of his cockpit.
NASA denies the astronaut encountered anything unexpected on the moon. Armstrong never discussed what was said in the missing 2 minutes of audio.
He turned inward. He became a very private person. The one thing that he did do, though, is to go on this expedition into this cave. And we have to wonder, what was he hoping to find in this dark, subterranean world? What did he think was going to be down there?
Social science professor Petronio Jaramillo claimed to have seen the ancient metal library in 1946 when he was just 17, following a map given to him by his uncle.
From his accounts, it sounded like Haramija was describing Aladdin's cave.
The library itself was amazing to behold. Thousands of volumes of metal books, each weighing about 40 pounds, and on the pages are impressed characters and symbols. If there's one in a million chance that it's true, shouldn't we go back and look for this golden library?
30 years after Jaramillo claimed to have found the library, Armstrong sets out to discover if the legend is real.
Getting to the entrance of this cave is a nightmare. You're talking dense jungle, you're talking crazy animals that can kill you, viruses, all kinds of hazards. It's literally Indiana Jones.
To enter this mysterious underworld is treacherous.
It's literally this black void in this big abyss.
Once inside the caverns, Armstrong and Hall are awestruck.
They made their way through chamber after chamber of cathedral-sized spaces.
It looks as if these chambers, so inaccessible and so far from human civilization, have not been formed by natural processes.
The caves had straight walls and right-angle turrets, unlike any other natural formation.
This must be thousands of years old. So how is this possible?
As Armstrong presses further into the cave complex, he makes a macabre find.
They actually came upon a burial chamber. There was a seated skeleton that was dated to 1500 BC.
1500 BC predates King Tutankhamun. It predates the siege of Troy. At this distant time, Ecuador was one of the most advanced areas in all of the Americas.
The tomb was located in such a way that the rays of sunlight on the summer solstice would come through the cave entrance and strike this tomb. So it appears to perhaps have had some kind of cosmological significance the way it had been placed.
This was not just a typical burial. This was an important person in an important location.
The light, the skull, the tomb. Armstrong feels that strange metal library must be close. For the first man on the moon, a journey to the center of the Earth in search of an elusive legendary metal library.
The culture that put it there, it was more advanced than we think.
Armstrong finds weird chambers and a 3,500-year-old skeleton in a strangely illuminated tomb. But after venturing several miles along difficult tunnels, the expedition is forced to turn back.
My father and Neil Armstrong did not find the treasure, but they mapped about 10 miles worth of the cave system. But it's known now that this system stretches far beyond. We could be looking at hundreds of miles worth of cave systems.
Armstrong returns to his farm in Ohio and doesn't discuss why he went looking for the legendary library.
What did he feel was so important down there in that hole that he was willing to sign his name onto this venture?
He became more and more reclusive, according to some people, and he was a very private man to begin with, but whatever his experiences were, I think they tended to kind of close him off.
But then, in 1994, at the White House, 20 years after his quest to find the ancient metal library, Armstrong gives a strangely worded speech.
We have only completed a beginning. We leave you much that is undone. There are great ideas undiscovered, breakthroughs available to those who can remove one of truth's protective layers.